Hello everyone, I am Pragya Shivastava, an educator on Unacademy. Follow me on Unacademy Learning app, where you'll find my many more courses. Do rate, review and share my courses to keep me motivated and deliver you more. And this lesson is all about the different types of foundations. Foundation is that part of the structure that connects and transmits the load from the structure to the ground soil such that the soil does not fail in shear or the settlement is within safe limits. These are the two main points that is actually taken care of while designing our foundation. Now let's see the objective of providing foundation. To distribute the load of the structure over large bearing area. Second one, to load the bearing surface at uniform rate so as to avoid unequal settlement and to prevent lateral movement of supporting material and to increase the stability of the structure as a whole. Now, to perform the function properly, a footing must be laid at a suitable depth below the ground surface. The vertical distance between the ground surface and the base of the footing is known as the depth of footing. And as per IS 1080-1962, minimum depth for all types of foundation should be at least 50 cm. Now the minimum depth actually ensures the availability of soil having safe bearing capacity. A foundation should be placed well below the level, which will not be affected by seasonal change of weather to cause swelling and shrinkage of the soil. And let me tell you that Rankine has given a formula to estimate the depth of the foundation. And according to Rankine's, the depth of the foundation, minimum depth of the foundation should be equal to Q upon gamma 1 minus sin phi by 1 plus sin phi whole square. And phi is your angle of internal friction, gamma being the unit weight, and Q is the load that is actually coming on from the structure. Though this formula is quite good, but it has its own drawback. What are the drawbacks of this formula? This load does not consider the load applied to the foundation. Does not consider the cohesion intercept C of the soil. And you can see what happens here is this theory gives bearing capacity of soil to be equal to zero if your depth of foundation is zero, which cannot be the case. And so it is actually contrary to our experience. So, but still, for our calculation purpose, we are actually using this formula. So you need to remember this depth of foundation to be equal to Q upon gamma 1 minus sin phi by 1 plus sin phi whole square. Now the footing should be located below the topsoil. And the topsoil consists of organic matter which eventually decomposes. So your depth of footing should start from below the topsoil level. Footing should be carried below the depth of frost penetration. You should always note that footing should be placed below the potential cover depth if located in streams or in water bodies.
The footing should be placed above the ground water table if possible, or you can say as far as possible, and the footing must go below a zone of weakened soil, which may be because of presence of roots or due to burrowing of animals or due to presence of faults or mines or caves. Now, let's see the total load that is actually being acted upon on our foundation, which needs to be taken care of. There can be dead load. I hope you all remember, dead load is the weight of materials permanently fixed to the structure. Can be beams, floors, walls, columns, or attached service equipments. Live loads are all the movable loads during the useful life of the structure. It can be peoples, goods, furniture, equipments, or machineries. Then wind load. Wind load, which depends upon the velocity of wind and type of structure. Snow loads, due to accumulation of snow on the roofs in the cold climate areas. Then there can be earth pressure. Earth pressure is the lateral force on the structure below ground surface, for which we have already studied about it. And water pressure, the lateral force against structure which is actually below your water level. Then earthquake also carries load, because it depends upon the seismicity of the area of the zone. We add the some loading for earthquake loads also. And our design load is generally sum of dead load plus live load. When if wind load is less than 25% of dead load plus live load, that means if wind load is less than this much, we are going to neglect wind load for our calculation of dead load and live loads. And for if your wind load is more than 25% of dead load plus live load, then only we consider wind load in our calculation for the design load, which may come on our foundation. Now let's see the different types of foundations that is actually there. There are so many foundations. Broadly, it can be categorized as shallow foundation and deep foundation. Foundation is called shallow foundation when D upon V, depth upon width, is less than 1, and it is a deep foundation if D upon V is more than 1. There can be a variety of shallow foundations. There can be mat foundation, cantilever, which is also called strap footing. Then there can be combined footing, isolated footing, or simply wall footing. These are further subclassified. Mat foundation or raft foundation can be subdivided as flat slab, thickened under column, two-way beam and slab type. It can be a flat slab with pedestal, or it can be a rigid frame type or a piled mat. And deep foundations are also of different types available. It can be a pile foundation or a pier foundation, or it can be a well foundation. Well foundations can be again of three more types: open caissons, pneumatic caissons, and box caissons. And piles are further subdivided. If the basis of division is on function, then it can be a bearing pile, friction pile, or a combined bearing and friction pile. Based on the material chosen for our piles, it can be classified as timber piles, concrete pile, or a steel pile. And based on the method of installation, the piles can be categorized as large displacement pile, small displacement pile, or it can be a non-displacement pile. So these are the different types of footings. There are more to it. There are more in your isolated footing and well footings, for which we will be studying in our next lesson. And we'll please go through this chapter, because from next lessons we'll have to start the design part, where we will see more of this type of different types of well footings, how they do actually look in plan and elevation. And before that, please go through the chapter. You should know the basics of all these things before starting the design part. And so see you in our next lesson. Till meanwhile, keep studying.